Okay, yeah, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to begin this session. It's only 1 hour framing the topic. Like Ryan was saying, that the topic is a mouthful, it's a lot of words. So maybe it will help with the input from both our speakers now, Jerald and Dato Saifuddin, who will have 15 minutes each to expand or to discuss the topic. And after that, we will have 30 minutes. We'll open it to the floor so that we can hear your feedback or your questions or even your comments. Yeah. So I would like to invite Dato Saifuddin, yeah, first, to maybe your 15 minutes of your input.
Saudara Jerald and brothers and sisters. First and foremost, I would like to thank Pusat Komas and commend you guys on organizing the sixth conference. And it's good to be among friends who are passionate about looking at ways in how we can work better, not only in the context of fostering better unity, but I believe this is as part of our work in building a better country for all, building a great nation, membina sebuah negara ulung, that is advanced, prosper and happy, ya, negara ulung yang maju, makmur dan bahagia. I will divide my intervention into a couple of things, briefly on what I understand as extremism, and then on racism, and then a little bit on moderation, though I will leave that to Adli, who will be speaking more about it later on. I saw Daniel, who was with me in GMM before, who may also discuss that later. And finally, what are the kinds of innovation that is needed? I'm not going to give you a shopping list of innovation, but I will give you only one area which is very specific to politics, the thing that I am probably good at, the only thing that I'm good at. Yeah. Okay. Is extremism and racism mutually reinforcing? The answer is yes and no, depending on the context, depending on the situation. I would, at the outset, say we should worry because there is always the possibility that extremism and racism are actually reinforcing the other. Yeah. When we look at extremism, because of today's hotly debated issue on Daesh and ISIS and whatnot, I think it is important to start by saying that extremism, the objective of extremism, is not only and not always religious. I think we have to clarify that. At the outside, yeah, extremism is not only and not always because of religion. There are many other reasons why one become extreme in his or her view. It could be for nationalistic reason. We are fortunate to have someone from Myanmar or Burma here today to share perhaps what is happening or what was happening in Burma. Independence struggle could end up in some kind of extremist views and actions. The other set of reason why extremism occurs or happen is because there are people who believe that you need to do reform for whatever reason. You need to replace existing government. You need to replace existing system. We have someone from Indonesia who is most able to speak about reform. Yeah, welcome, sister. So there are two sets of main objectives or factors that makes someone or some groupings become extremists or involved in some kind of extremism. That is, on the one hand, it is about, as I said, not only and not always because of religion, but it could be because you do have a religious extremism, because of nationalism, because of independence struggle. The other set could be reform in many ways, in many forms. Of course, there can always be a combination of the two. In most cases around the world, we will find that the main root cause would be issues regarding civil liberties, lack of political representation, failure of political movements, injustice, and economic issues. So it's about bread and butter. Yeah. So you can have different objectives, but when you look at why those objectives become an objective, you look at the root cause of it, then again you see two sets of things. One is civil liberties, the other one is bread and butter issues, economics. In the context of ISIS, I know we are not discussing terrorism, but I observed that the Komas, Pusat Komas introduction did mention ISIS, and I think, well, we pray that we don't have this problem here, though we know that we have some problem, yeah, not within the country, but our countrymen going abroad. I'm simply using Fawaz Jaja's conclusion as to the four reasons why ISIS, not why ISIS is formed or was established, but more how did they become what they are today, especially in Syria and Iraq. This book is quoted by Fariz Zakaria. According to Fariz Zakaria, this is the best book on ISIS thus far. The title of the book is ISIS, A History, Fawaz Jaja's. Four reasons. Number one, it is an extension of Al-Qaeda International, which is a creature of the 2003 US-led invasion of Iraq and its aftermath. The rest is academic. We can look at the literatures. But it started there. Why? Because the US-led invasion simply destroy further the state institution. So you have havoc, you have anarchy, and anarchy is the best platform for extremism and terrorism. The second factor is the fragmentation of the post-Saddam Hussein political establishment, partly because of the US-led invasion. But because Saddam Hussein's rule did not articulate policies that emphasize the country's identity, so it gives room to the Sunni-Shia divide, yeah, which we all know now is becoming perhaps worse. The third factor is the breakdown of state institutions in Syria. The second factor was what happened in Iraq. The third factor is what happened in Syria. The fourth one is most interesting to me: the derailment of the Arab Spring uprisings. So if you compare the four factors why ISIS become what they are today to my earlier presentation about the objective and root cause, you will find some similarities. Yeah, civil liberties, the breakdown of lack of political representation, and so on and so forth. Now, what about racism? I'm using Dr. Uiki Beng's definition about what is a racialist and what is a racist. Yeah. According to Dr. Kibeng, a racialist or racialism is the promotion of race as an elementary classification of humans in public discourse. This may expressly inform government policymaking, or it may not. But the idea of race, however unclear, is accepted as a relevant part of much of Malaysia's social interaction. A racialist is someone who is conscious about race and is accepting of it as and accept it as something not problematic. This does not make him a racist, but racialism is a prior condition for racism. So if you ask me, is UMNO a racist party? No. It is a racialist party. A racist, according to Kibeng, is someone who feels or shows disdain for others based upon their racial affiliation. This may be by virtue of prescribed traits and prejudice observations. Whatever the case, he or she sees racial division as moral one. The problem with racism in this country is when you have politics of race. Politics of race is when the state makes race and when the state sanctions racial discrimination. It is about how government use laws, policies, and state institutions involving race in order to win election and to stay in power. First, they create racial categories. Remember that race is a social and political construct. Later, they administer race, and they follow through by remaking the racial categories they have created, sometimes with innovations. In the context of the NUCC, the National Unity Consultative Council, we discuss Bumiputra at length. And at the end of the day, it was a 50-50 thing, Denison. We can't decide whether we should really put this into our recommendation, but we told the Prime Minister that we should actually inspect the term Bumiputra and how it has been used or misused in the past. Politics of race become worse when you add religious flavor to it. Hence, you have, if suddenly there is a heavy rain outside, perhaps it is politically correct to say it rains cats and sausage. And you cannot visit A&W on Tuesday and order corny dog. Yeah, the corny dog is one of my favorite. Now, how then moderation come into become relevant and very important? I'm not going to go into the details of moderation, but I would position moderation as the platform for centripetalism in politics or centrist politics. Now I'm going to the last part, moving towards the last part of my intervention. Moderation, if we were to apply it in all areas of our life, including or perhaps especially in politics in this country, I think we can find a lot of common things that can make us work better as a nation. The problem is when sometimes some people in this country, and I'm referring more to the majority, the Muslims, suffer from some kind of siege mentality, as if you wake up in the morning and you know, someone is trying to take away the country and so on and so forth. Now, if you have this, if you suffer from siege mentality, you can't see moderation going to operate in any way. But a true Muslim would understand that the Quran provides sufficient guidelines. It starts with, for instance, the verse in Surah Al-Anbiya, Islam is a mercy to all. And all here means Muslim and non-Muslim. Islam rahmatan lil alamin. Islam acknowledges and celebrates plurality and diversity. Because if Allah so will, He could have made you all, He could have made all of you one people, An-Nahli, the verses from An-Nahli. But in another verse, Al-Hujurat, Allah said that He created you from male and female and made you peoples and tribes that you may know each other, not that you may despise each other. In another surah, Al-Baqarah, you talk about let there be no compulsion in religion. And in another surah, Islam forbids Muslims from causing discomfort to people of other faith. And there are that famous covenant between Prophet Muhammad and the Christians during his time, where Prophet Muhammad guaranteed the safety and security of Christians under Muslim governance. And the most famous surah quoted by even my non-Muslim friend in this country is about lita'arafu. Islam encouraged the use of to know each other. Yeah, the one that I was saying earlier on, and the other one is the fact that Islam encouraged the use of wisdom and dialogues in ways that are best and most gracious in attending to our affairs. And even if there is dispute, there's another verse talking about let not the hatred of others to you make you swerve to wrong and depart from justice. Be just, that is next to piety. These are very clear verses of the Holy Quran that guides and teaches Muslim about moderation, about knowing the other, the non-Muslim, and not just knowing the other, but cooperating with the other. Yeah. So if we understand this, then the Mufti won't use Kafe Harbi. Yeah. Because there's no place for Kafe Harbi in today's nation, because we all subscribe to democracy. You talk to any fuqaha, any ulama who understands, who works on the fiqh, on Islamic Sharia law, Kafe Harbi and Kafir Zimmi are not terms that people use in today's context. People talk about, like Al-Qardawi, he speaks about brotherhood in citizenship among Muslim and non-Muslim, because we are, by definition, equal in the context of democracy. So my last point, Mr. Chairperson, is what then in politics in Malaysia? And please, I'm not talking here, I'm not speaking as Secretary of Pakatan Harapan. Yeah? This is about the need for a new political configuration. Mark my word, yeah? Not about new government. Yeah, it's about new political configuration. I mean, most of you know who I am and you know where I'm coming from. I'm not that kind of politician. Today, racialized politics in this country is represented by the practice of consortialism. I find this mouthful. Consortialism. Yeah, consortialism. Consortialism. That's the word. Yeah. Where you bargain and compromise according to or between race. Yeah. This works for some time. It happens to be the BN model. Yeah. The problem is, with GE13 and beyond, until today, we seems to be going into a more extreme configuration. And I'm not, this is not my term, this is a term used by scholars in ISIS in Singapore. We are becoming more, we are seeing more Malay Bumiputera dominant configuration. It's a Malay Bumiputera dominant model. If UMNO and PAS were to work together, then you may have Malay Bumiputera Muslim dominant. Now, what is the effect? You will have Malay Bumiputera Muslim in government. You have non-Malay, non-Bumiputera, in particular Chinese non-Muslim in opposition. That means bad for Malaysia. Yeah. And I don't think God-fearing politician should embark on that journey. So what is the innovation? Well, the innovation is not because we want to come up with something new out of the box, but it has been done somewhere else, including in some of our neighboring countries, not excluding Indonesia, is centripetalism. It's not a new term. It is a political science terminology. Centripetalism, it is about being centrist. It is about being inclusive. Yeah, it's about being moderate. We can discuss this at length, but these are the basic thing that we need to do. So it doesn't matter on which political divide you are. Yeah. I think we should work on establishing that new political configuration. And if you ask me as a politician, what would the innovation be? I think this is going to be a milestone in as far as social and political policies are concerned in this country. Because if this is going to be the main, the overriding theme of politics, then you will answer politics of race. You will answer the problem with religious flavor that is added to politics of race. And then you will have a different view of looking at many of the policies and programs. Thank you.
Good morning, friends. I'm happy to be here. As a SUHAKAM commissioner, I know many of you know me. My history is from the NGO world, and Komas is one of my organizations I've been actively involved in. So I'm very happy to be here with my fellow commissioner, Mr. Francis from Sarawak. I think another commissioner has also joined us. I'm also going to give, I also realize just now Tan Johan introduced all of us from which part and which country. There's a Malaysian friend here who's from Melbourne, one of our Malaysians in Melbourne. So can we give a hand to Praveen there? Can you stand up, Praveen? Yeah, he's one of our Malaysian activists in Australia. I don't know what he's doing here for this conference all the way, so we can ask him. Okay, before I start, I want to just acknowledge, last year I remember we invited for the same conference a friend called Mr. Firosho Kameh. He's from South Africa. He's an old activist from the apartheid regime period and continued, but sadly he has just recently passed away 1 month ago, so I want to acknowledge that we remember him. He's been struggling for breaking racial politics in South Africa and the world, and he was our speaker. So as we do this conference, remember many people who have gone before us as they continue to struggle for a world where equality is a part of our nation. Okay. I've got a few slides. Okay, so I'm going to start. There are friends from the Orang Asli community here. This is a quote that I keep remembering whenever we discuss about racial politics in Malaysia. The Orang Aslis who have been here for hundreds of years or even longer, thousands of years, you know, their drawings, the Perak Man, 25,000 years. Actually, the Perak Man is from the Orang Asli community in Greek. Greek is the border for friends out of Malaysia, border with Thailand. This is what they say. We just want our rights to be respected. Although we were here first, we are happy to live together with all others. So the reason I quote this is one of the Orang Asli leaders, and they are there. The leaders are at the back from these, this JKOASM. Because they're saying if we play the game of who came here first, which is what is happening in Malaysia, you go back to China, you go back to India, pendatang, you know, then we will never stop the game. Who came here first? And the Orang Aslis will ask all of us to go out. Then we, all of us here in this hall, except for the four of them, won't have a place to live if we go by that game of who came here first. So this is a picture of the blockade in Kelantan. SUHAKAM, I visited them last week to find out what's happening, why they're putting a blockade. And they're not chasing people out from the area, they're protecting the area. You know. So if the Orang Aslis have a consciousness of living together with others, despite us doing horrendous things to the indigenous community of Malaysia over the last 200 years by all types of groups who have come to Malaysia, yet they say we want to live together with you, then the challenge for us to actually find out how to change that politics that Dato Saifuddin speaks of. We've seen this image many times, you know, we have a beautiful Malaysia. Have you all seen this enough on the television? Malaysia, truly Asia, and beautiful Malaysia, tourism. So all this is there. It's there. Malaysia has this beauty. So this is a very famous cartoon that from the Komas books. When foreigners come here and say, ah, Malaysia, you know, is a land of multiracial, multireligious. But although I believe all countries in the world are multiracial, multireligious, but after they leave the airport, then they are shocked because this is what they see. You know, just outside the airport, then you see, if you come for elections, everybody is fighting based on race. The politics of, you know, trying to woo the Chinese voter, the Malay voter, the Iban voter. Everybody is using race consciousness, not Malaysian consciousness. And I think that's why if we go down that line, we're already in dangerous waters now, but if we continue, then this concept of racism breeding extremism will continue. So this is something for us to think about. I also want to remember that we are all not racist because I know we also have the heart to think and feel for others. Malaysia, like other ASEAN nations, there's this very strong sense of solidarity for so many issues, and I've listed the issues. Which means Malaysia, the people of Malaysia, the government of Malaysia know how to feel for people who are suffering discrimination. And, you know, we've always shown solidarity to the Palestinians, to South Thailand, to Philippines, to Bosnians, Rohingya, Syria, even the Tamils from Sri Lanka, which means this is a positive thing we have in our hearts to break the politics of divide. But yet, a lot of this is only for outside consumption. What is the inside consumption in Malaysia is a question for us to ask. I think Dato' Saifuddin differentiated about racialism and racist. I think that's in his book also, or Keeping's quote. Just a simple definition of what racial discrimination is. Any distinction, exclusion, restriction, or preference based on race, color, descent, or in Malaysia is more national ethnic origin. Which, I think that's the second part, is the most important. I think if you identify yourself, you belong to whichever community, there's no problem. But if you identify and the purpose or effect of nullifying or impairing the recognition, enjoyment of exercise on equal footing of human rights and fundamental freedoms, then that is racial discrimination. So Malaysia, we feel this, we sense this, and it keeps coming out from time to time, sometimes more loudly by individuals who will spew all kinds of extreme speech, you know, and this is very easy now on the social media. Anything is said just goes out, okay? So my thinking of the link between racism and extremism is that if racism, this Malaysian difficulty, and I think many of us will always say, before it was much better, you know, when we were younger in school, we were going to each other's houses, eating each other's food, we were all so friendly, loving, yet not less religious. We were all as Muslim, as Buddhist, as Christian before, but something has changed now, you know. So I think we need to change the thinking, and this is linked to, I think, what Dato' Saifuddin actually spoke directly to it, no? We need to change the political configuration. Because now, the challenge is anybody wants to sell politics or sell to get votes is that you want to defend what is truth. So, if our promotion is that there is only one truth, and if everybody claims only one truth and we are fighting, then it's dangerous. Believe that the majority has the authority on the national narrative, and this is what many people are challenging. Who decides what is Malaysia? Is it the government of the day? Is it the writers of history that only give one side of history? And this for me is dangerous. This is what breeds racism. Belief of the other is the danger zone. So I think the siege mentality that Dato' Saifuddin spoke about, that we are being under siege from another group, whoever this other group, you know. Morning when you wake up, he says, do we feel we are under siege? But some people are firing up the fears and imagination. And then this grows. And this is why the danger is there, because then you feel you need to join other people and other forces for similar extreme cause to uphold this truth. And there is where Malaysia is now struggling. And then for the few who get taken up by some of the invitations from more extremist groups, believe that extreme measures needs to be taken to secure this truth. So my premise is that Malaysia has been having racial discrimination for years. It's institutionalized because of the politics, because of the politics of history. But my question to all of us is, how come suddenly things have grown that even it's easy to recruit our youth to go and fight a cause of extremism and terrorism? How is it suddenly became easy? Why are youth buying into this idea? Because the last 20 over years, this so-called truth was left unchecked. People selling that this is our nation, this is our religion, we have to defend it, we have to fight. Of course, then those who believe in it easily, without a critical thinking, without a Malaysian thinking that the nation belongs to all, easily buy into it. So we are now reaping what the politics of racism did in the last 20 years. So of course now the government is struggling, the police is struggling to stop this extremism and growth of terrorism. They are now trying to plug what they should have done 20 years ago. And I hope this conference today will address these issues. And then that's where the innovative solutions. But we need to recognize what's happening in the country. So I would say, nothing new. You know, we have institutionalized racism through prolonged affirmative action policy. Affirmative action policy in itself is not bad. It's needed. But it has to be very specific in its objective and agenda. It has to be time-bound. Any affirmative action that goes on forever and ever and ever is institutionalized racism. So in human rights world, affirmative action is the human rights concept, but only in as far as it is specific to an objective and it's time-bound. Malaysia's NEP was supposed to expire in 1990. It got extended 10 years. If it keeps getting extended, this is the price we are paying. This is why our police is now trying to stop all this extremist thinking. But we should have stopped this long time ago. We should not have allowed our politicians to play the race card in resolving Malaysia's difficulty. And you know the history of divide and rule started even way before Merdeka. So that project of the British sekarang disambung oleh orang kita sendiri. So this is some of the challenges. My point is, it could be incidences like this, the Lawyat Plaza. It could be a small incident, not a problem, because we can stop it, police can stop it, politicians can stop it. But sadly, if politicians use that to fire up, something is wrong. So that's why the change in the political thinking, we need to reject race-based politics. And that was last year's theme for the conference. Sadly, after the Lawyer Plaza, it's a criminal act. The police, the AG will know how to handle criminal act. Tapi, politicians fired it up, and what happened? The politicians took it one step further. Let's have a Malay-only, a Bumiputra-only digital mall. How come the response to thuggery or criminal offence is a race-based digital mall? Apa kaitan dia, these two? So the politicians keep this because it's in their benefit to sell race politics. So I pity our enforcement officers, people like you and I who are concerned and want to stop this, but it's difficult because we are just the symptom only. We're just stopping here, but the underlying, we're not changing the configuration, and that is dangerous for our nation. Of course, you've seen this. Dress code was never an issue, and you see her dressing is decent, but Selangor State Secretary, I think you remember this, kena stop juga. So where did that person get the idea this is salah? We were much more tolerant, much more accepting community. What happened? Then, of course, you have more crude people like the red T-shirt Jamal and all that who want to protest against Berse. So for me, you want to protest based on whatever you want. That's not a problem. But if you racialize the protest, and this is what my point is, you know, racially motivating that, oh, Berse is Chinese, and so we Malays have to come. Why that? He could do his protest rally and say, I want to fight for whatever he wants to fight. But why racialize even a rally demanding for free and fair elections? The only question the red T-shirts you need to ask is, don't they believe in free and fair elections? That's the only question that they need to ask. But any point for racializing gets a lot of traction. And where are the voices of politicians? We know about Biro Tata Negara. What is taught there, it's come out many times when PowerPoints are put on viral. Time and time again, saying this is supposed to teach about being Malaysian, being patriotic, not about a politics, a narrative that is biased. But that's not only Malaysian suffering. Foreigners also suffer because this was captured in Komas' report on racial discrimination this year. There is one, I don't think you can see it, but there is a banner that says, foreigners don't come and live in this condo. Although they are renting, they are paying, but xenophobia is also. So it's not only orang Malaysia kena, but orang luar also now will get it. Eh? So my final slides are, I think if we want to stop the growth of extremism, we need to stop the growth of racial discrimination. And I would call it, we need to dismantle the historical and political convenient mischief. And that's where I think the possibility of innovative responses may arise. Okay? So ethnic and religious-based party must be inclusive. You and I must say, hey, enough. This old politics, tak boleh pakai. Public education. But where's our majority? How come all these parties can still survive? All parties are not only Semenanjung, Sabah, Sarawak pun main politics based on ethnic grouping. Policies of divide and rule must be abolished or dismantled. The legal reappraisal of our constitution, laws, on how to make it more inclusive. Exploitation of fears, I think Dato spoke about it, about siege mentality. We need to expose, so we need more media exposure, public awareness. The media, every front page of some newspapers, always we are under attack. You know, kena bersiap sedia melawan orang China ke orang luar. So, why do they give these messages? Better understanding of human rights and respect. So how can human rights cut across? It's not about majority versus minority, because then if that's the case, every country with the majority will win and kill the minority. But human rights is dignity for all. So human rights education is needed. Clearer understanding of the need for affirmative action. I think I spoke about limitation of affirmative action. It cannot be a blank check, huh? Like what is being done by politicians now. You know, Article 153 is an affirmative action, but it has provisions to be inclusive of all other Malaysians. So even when that article was put, it was designed to remember everybody in Malaysia. Racist and hate speech. That should be a no-no in Malaysia. But you can do it in Malaysia. You can even get claps. You can get ministers also supporting. Yesterday, there was a photo of Khairi sitting with Jamal Yunus having breakfast somewhere. Khairi should be giving a different message. He criticizes Jamal and then having breakfast with Jamal. So where are our thinking politicians? You cannot play this politics now because everybody is watching everyone. So that reconfiguration of politics, I think every leader needs to step up. Every leader needs to step up. And then appreciation of history away from political alignment. Not the history is written by siapa yang nak jual a certain kind of script, but a Malaysia that truly belongs to all. So honesty in our academia and intellectual spheres of Malaysia needs to come back. People cannot write because they are subservient to the government of the day. So for me, the best innovation is believing that silence is not an option. Too many Malaysians just keep quiet, and I don't know why. You keep quiet, this is the Malaysia we inherit. The dignity of all Malaysians are at stake, and the human rights of all are affected if this racism goes unchecked. So I hope this conference challenges that notion that racism has a direct link with the growth of extremism, and we need to put a stop to racism, which means we put a stop to extremism. So this conference is one of the education awareness building. I believe that Malaysia was designed for all, and we must reclaim that Malaysia for all. And I live in hope that we must reclaim that space for all Malaysians. Thank you.
Thank you, Jerald, for inspiring input. Before we open the floor for response, just a few main points that came out from starting from Dato Saifuddin's speech or input. It's very interesting. He talks about the root cause of extremism. Yeah, mainly there are many. One of which is about reform. Reform even leading to nationalism. Yeah, and basically always stems out from issues of wanting to reform political, social structures, civil liberties, bread and butter issue. Yeah. Also talks about the difference between racialists and racists. He also threw a lot of very big words that even he could not pronounce. But these are very important things because these concepts actually describe a lot of our daily existence and reality. Jerald points out very important questions about who actually really decides what and who is Malaysia. And when some group thinks that they are the ones to decide on that, to determine that, then it's very dangerous. And lays, it breeds that siege mentality which both the speakers talk about. The fact that you're insecure, that somebody is trying to rob you of something, you know, and then you convince others. And Jerald talks about why are the youth so easily convinced than compared to 20 years ago. And there must be something wrong. You know, why are they buying into these ideas? Because it's unchecked. Because of 20 years of unchecked racist behaviors, attitudes and actions and even policies substantiated by legality. Yeah. So one of the examples is the affirmative action must be time-bound. It is a very well-known human rights concept. Affirmative action cannot be renewed over and over again because politicians want to buy favor or to want to gain political ground. And that's why leading to the point of racial politics, which very much governs the society in Malaysia today. So innovative action is needed. Both speakers talk about reforms, yeah, political reforms, media reforms, reviewing of the laws, respecting human rights, especially racist expressions and attitudes and behaviors must be checked. And in that sense, it is a kind of realignment of society, including the historical perspective of who we are, how we are, and what we must do today. We cannot keep quiet, cannot keep silent, but to voice out, because otherwise we will repeat what has happened in the last 20 years, according to how Jerald has spoken. So now, with that in mind, maybe I would open the floor now for maybe Yeah, 10 minutes, a few responses, comments. But please try to keep it short and clear. If you are interested, please come out to the microphones which have been set up on the left and the right, and then just introduce yourself and ask your question or give your comment. Yeah, silakan, the floor is open. Yeah.
My name is Praveen. I'm from a group called Sayana Bangsa Malaysia in Melbourne. Good morning, everyone. So, not a comment, question rather, to the panelists. I think many of us have, many of us here and our friends agree with what has been said this morning by the both of you. But what are some of the practicable solutions? What can we do when we are, in essence, politically constrained? Thank you.
Thank you. Maybe we will collect a few comments before the speaker's response. Andrew, are you walking up to the... Yeah, okay.
Good morning. Andrew Koo from the Bar Council. Two comments, stroke questions for each of you to respond to. In January this year, Malaysia hosted a conference on de-radicalization and countering violent extremism. And in the presentation by the Malaysian government, the representative, oddly enough, from the religious department, basically identified three threats to Malaysia from a national security perspective. The first was liberalism. The second was pluralism. And the third was this new thing called LGBTism. And I'm just wondering that if that's the official position of the government, how does that sit with a government that is trying to move forward on eliminating, sorry, it's early in the morning, racial discrimination? So that's the first comment question. The second is what Jerald mentioned. I mean, we had an NEP that was supposed to end in 1990s, gone on 2010, 2020. Now we're even talking about maybe 2050 or something like that. So the question is, it breeds in each successive generation an idea that this is no longer just a special position, which is the wording of Article 153 of the Constitution, but it becomes a privilege or a right even, which is so entrenched then that cannot be moved and cannot be negotiated. So does that not then further contribute to the problems that we face going forward? Thank you.
Thank you, Andrew. Yes. Dr. Nasir, maybe the microphone? Yeah.
My name is Nasir. maybe we should also talk about the push-pull factor because they are interrelated, and that's what we're getting out of that. One, the struggle between the superpowers for the resources and the process of divide and rule where you can break up race and religion. The other aspect, which in itself will create momentum, the other aspect is the characters of the Muslims themselves. What's happening? Because when we talk about extremism, it's related to the Muslims, basically. Yeah? And has been mentioned about the characters, I mean, beauty of the Quran and Islam, but why things are happening. I think we have to go deep inside to find out why this should happen, simply because usually when people criticize Islam, it's more of the hadith rather than the Quran. Because if it had been described about the Prophet, he is of the best character, he is the Quran, and God protects him from all sins. But the hadith doesn't show that way. It's a certain aspect, we are not saying hadith is wrong. If hadith strengthen the Quran, it's okay. But it's added few things, like stoning doesn't exist in the Quran, and if you look at the hadith, Sahih Bukhari, it's about cutting up people, cutting the tongue, and killing them, and stoning them, which is not in the Quran. And these are the facts that have been brought up by the ulama. And the ordinary people listen to them, and suddenly we have this kind of tendencies. So I think we should look into this matter. If not, we just relegate it to something else, like, you know, oh, you know, they are behaving this way, because they are pushing in that direction. Of course, I'm not saying that, you know, because if you talk about hadith, then you're being condemned. But I think we should be seriously looking to it, because if you ask me from my reading, is this anti-science, anti-woman, violence? When Prophet, and it's supposed to be coming from the voice of Prophet Muhammad. But Prophet Muhammad is the Quran. So there is a contradiction in itself. So basically, we should look into not only about exploitation, about resources, about monopoly, but we also talk about the character of the person. Why are they behaving that way? Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, we have maybe one last comment from Dr. Dennison, and we open it to the speakers, because otherwise this session will become the whole forum itself. So.
Thank you, Chair. I can't resist asking my close friend, Dato Saifuddin, a question. Because he called for the sort of end of race and religious-based politics. And I know you are not here on your capacity, your political capacity, but I just thought it might be good for you to try and articulate similarity and differences between the two major equations, between the Barisan and the Pakatan. In terms of political parties, the equation seems to be almost the same. Chinese-dominated party, Malay-dominated party, Islamist party, but it seems to be more progressive in its outlook. But end of the day, in terms of party elections, it tends to be very race-centric in one sense. Secondly, if you take state government and their performance, EXCOs and other sort of things, the portfolios at state government, Penang, and even Selangor, the portfolios on minorities tend to be very similar in the Barisan model in Selangor and Penang. So is there hope actually coming in terms of this, or are all political parties guilty of this? So what kind of hope is there from an alternative framework that is aggressively moving towards ideology, position, strategizing in that way? I think it's more asking that to see that concern. And now that you are there, how is that being played so that that alternative is visible, there's an alternative dialogue in terms of practice, conduct of politicians, the civil service or local government? Is it really different when it comes to politics, the day-to-day politics and the way they mobilize? Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, we'll move immediately to these four questions or comments, which Dato Saifuddin, now it's the pointing finger game, yeah? Dato, maybe you could respond.
Yeah, thank you to all friends. Being the first to answer, I can choose lah, which one not to answer, and then Dennison will have to answer the rest. What can we do given the political constraint? First of all, attend Bersih 5. write in columns or write on online newspapers and share and do whatever that is possible. We have not reached a situation where you can't speak up at all. The only situation that we have now is we are not sure whether you will be given the comfort of freedom of speech after you have spoken. You may speak as you will, but no guarantees what's going to happen after that. I'm sure there are things that we can do, and there are things that we can creatively do while understanding the political constraint. I would say don't be scared, don't be fearful, as something that is very important. This is, of course, I'm responding to the Human Rights Watch 2015 report entitled "Deepening Culture of Fear." Andrew, you are referring to someone who come from the threats, liberalism, pluralism, LGBT. This is really about how he or she interprets the teachings of Islam. I think people who read, people who understand, people who comprehend the contemporary discourses, people who read Tariq Ramadan and many of the other scholars will understand that that is the one that you were alluding to is not the way to describe Islam, and that is not the way to position Islam in today's world. Even some of the da'wah organization, even some of the Islamic movement in this country, even if they cannot agree on LGBT, I have to underline this word very carefully, yeah, so that I do not leave you an impression where you will misconstrue what this Islamic organization are saying. Even if they cannot agree on LGBT issues, they will strongly say you cannot discriminate. They see that there are you see, so there are some Islamic organizations who may find it difficult to say, yes, we support the rights of the LGBT. So they won't come in that language, but they will definitely come out strongly saying, you must protect their rights. So that, to me, is not something that all of us will agree that that should be the way it is, but it is a step forward for many of the more progressive Islamic organizations. So definitely then, you are not looking at LGBT as a threat. So that is the discourse that is going on in some Islamic organization. Our sister from Indonesia may touch this issue later on, if you can, because I think Indonesia is more advanced in the scholars there. At least the Muslim scholars are more open in the way they discuss issues like LGBT. On the new economic policy, more often than not, advocates of the NEP spirit, as they call it, Semangat Dasar Ekonomi Baru. This is the way certain people look at the NEP. The NEP policy is no longer there, but the spirit is still living. So they look at Semangat Dasar Ekonomi Baru, or the spirit of NEP. The problem is, how do you look at 153? Some people, they read 153 halfway. That is a problem, because if you look at 153 on its own or halfway, it's going to be a problem, the special position. And again, do you understand it? Do you read it as the special position, or do you read as rights? Right. Two different things. The problem is when people look at special position and say it is the rights. Special position does not equal rights. Ini dua benda yang sangat berbeza, number one. Number two, you must read 153 together with the other provision in the Constitution. For instance, if I'm not mistaken, Andrew, 160, which actually means that 153 is not a standalone provision in the Constitution, and it does not cover everything. It covers, by definition, only four areas. I won't go into the detail. And if you read 160, if I'm not mistaken, it is about position and promotion in the public service. Now, I'm not saying, I'm not defending 153 here. I'm just saying, look, 153 has to be read together with the other provisions of the Constitution. All I'm saying is, if one were to look at 153 in that manner, meaning reading it together with 160 and the others, then you don't end up with a position that is so extreme on the special Malay position. Then you are able to read what was written in the right commission earlier on, that the term Bumiputra should actually be reviewed after 15 years of independence. Then you will understand why NUCC, as I was alluding to together Denison can watch for me, why there was a debate about whether we should continue using the term Bumiputra or not during the NUCC discussion. But if you don't see it that way, then you are dead. Then you will support Datuk Jamal Redshirt. Then you will say Khairi Jamaluddin is the most progressive politician in UMNO. Okay, now, Dr. Nasir highlighted two very important points. One, again, is the interpretation, Doctor. I will come to that later on. On the hadith, please, I think I understand what Dr. Nasir is trying to say. There are two discourses going on the issue of hadith. One, unfortunately, there are people who will very quickly point and say Dr. Nasir is anti-hadith. Now, I do not subscribe to that. Okay, I do not. Doctor, I know where you're coming from. I do not. That is the problem when people or critics saja are anti-hadith. So Jakim will come after you and Jaiz will come after you. No. I think Dr. Nasir come from the other discourse. Critical evaluation of the hadith, which is part of the hadith tradition in the first place. It's not an issue at all. The problem is when people make it an issue, and then you tak boleh discuss lah. Then you become hot dog again lah. Okay. So I understand that. We can differ on the criticism, but. Criticism by itself is not a problem because it is part of the hadith tradition. Otherwise, you don't have hadith sahih and hadith that is not sahih. Sahih means authentic. Yeah, authentic and non-authentic. So, to be able to discuss is a problem to some people. My underlying conclusion to both Andrew's question and Dr. Nasir is the ijtihad part lah. Yeah, we really have to. We have to enter into discussion, and today, and this is not a new thing, but this has been renewed. I think we should take comfort in the fact that there more and more scholars are now talking about the maqasid al-sharia, looking at the higher objective of the sharia, rather than the lateral meaning of the sharia. People who understand maqasid al-sharia will say hudud is not an issue because we are not going to implement it. Full stop. Yeah. I won't go into detail. Hayo, Denison, you still want to ask me in this question? I'm trying not to be biased. So I would recommend that you read Savaramutu, Nawab, and the other author who published a book. Published by ISIS in Singapore, Institute of Southeast Asian Studies. The title of the book is Coalition of the Coalition, which is a very good analysis on what happened in GE13 in the last general election. And the important differences between the communal politics of Barisan Nasional and the more centrist and progressive politics of the then Pakatan Rakyat, which is now defunct and replaced by Pakatan Harapan, which also continues basically what the Pakatan Rakyat's ideals minus the hudud issue. To put it simply lah, yeah. It's not as simple as that, but that's what it is. On Selangor and Penang, I think if I can rephrase your question, and again, not trying to run away from answering your question, I think we really need to ask Selangor and Penang, how reformist are you as a government? I think that's the biggest question. Yeah, is the Selangor state government and the Penang state government reformist, as promised? I think that is the main challenge. I think the portfolios are almost similar, but I think there are some differences here and there. I was talking to Tricia Yeo recently because she authored a book called the two states or the states of the something, comparing Penang and Selangor after GE 2008, and I was asking her, can you continue with a sequel? Then you can have a deeper understanding and independent outlook at what both Selangor and Penang are doing. I think the main word would be reform. How reformists are there? My last point, I think the need for political education, but I must admit the political situation have reached a deadlock between BN and Pakatan Rakyat. I don't think you can talk about bipartisanship anymore. I think it's already war. I'm a strong believer of bipartisanship, but you can only do bipartisan politics when the other is reasonable and work on a certain shared premise. The moment you defy logic, then you can't talk. You just have to declare war. A third party should come up. I think this is where civil society become more and more important. Educating the public about what politics is, what good politics is all about. Thank you.
Thank you. Just a quick addition because I know of time. The question of politics is, I think, Dato Saifuddin has been consistent from, he was a different color before, now a different color. I don't know what color you are now, but he speaks the same language. I think this is the principal politics of fighting racial politics. I think it's needed. Too few people stand up and speak out. And that's my first comment to Dato Denison. I agree with Andrew that this notion of affirmative action is a right is wrong. It's a privilege. It's a temporary measure. That's the logic and language of affirmative action. It's not a right. The language in the Constitution is not a right. It's a privilege. It's a special measure provision. My final point is on this word, which is always denounced as a bad word, liberalism. I think then we have to denounce the Rukunagara. Because the preamble to the Rukun Negara, Bahawasanya Negara Kita Malaysia Mendukung Cita-Cita Hendak. You remember when we were young in school, we used to take our hand. The preamble we forget. The preamble 1, 2, 3. One is about mencapai perpaduan. 2 is about cara hidup demokratik. 3 is mencipta satu masyarakat adil saksama. The 4th, menjamin satu cara liberal terhadap tradisi-tradisi kebudayaan yang kaya dan berbagai corak. In English, it means ensuring a liberal approach to a rich and diverse cultural tradition. This is our heritage. This is our framework. So those who are questioning this, are they anti-Rukun Negara? Because this is what the nation is built on, which means you probably don't belong to this nation. If you are trying to restructure what was the nation envisaged to be. So I think it's time those who have been quiet, because they fear that if they speak up, you know, they don't have the authority. You have the authority as Malaysians. We have the authority as Malaysians to tell these people enough of your narrow interpretation of what you think is right for Malaysia. History has spoken, our experience has spoken, and this Malaysia is a Malaysia of Rukun Negara. We have a framework, a principle, but I think we've not used it enough. We've allowed politicians to take it on and to make it the national narrative. And I think that's a wrong narrative. Hoping through this conference or others, we will be able to speak up. So I think those are just my contributions. I think most of it, Dato' Saifuddin has spoken. Thank you.
Thank you, Jerald, Dato' Saifuddin. Interesting insights and analysis. I'm sure this discourse will... Would you like to say something? But
yes.
Short,
yes.
Yeah? Comment.
Saya rasa sangat perlu. Saya tahu masa sudah habis, tapi saya rasa soalan ni mungkin agak bodoh, tapi saya rasa saya perlu tanya juga soalan ni. Okay? Okey, saya Tija, saya daripada jaringan kampung orang asli Semenanjung. Minta maaf sebab saya terpaksa ambil masa kamu orang yang sudah habis. Soalan saya adalah macam ni. Pernahkah terjadi dalam negara Malaysia ini satu penindasan bangsa yang teruk? Maksud saya, Melayu tindas Cina, Cina tindas India yang kau-kau. Lebih teruk daripada penindasan yang dirasai oleh orang asli. Because orang asli bilangan kami sangat kecil, kehidupan kami bila-bila sahaja boleh dilenyapkan. Sumber kami hutan, sumber ekonomi dan sebagainya menjadi rebutan orang-orang kaya raya di bandar-bandar. So, kami tak ada ruang untuk bersuara, tak ada pendidikan tinggi, tak ada kuasa dalam kerajaan dan sebagainya, tak ada kuasa dalam politik. Kan kami rasa macam sepatutnya kami yang berada dalam ketakutan yang melampau berbanding dengan masa kat luar di dalam negara ni. Tapi saya lihat fenomena yang sedang berlaku sekarang, orang di luar sana, di bandar sini yang berpendidikan tinggi, yang bilangan dia cukup besar, yang ada kuasa dalam kerajaan dan sebagainya, ada segala kemewahan, ada wang ringgit dan sebagainya, saya lihat mereka pula yang sangat takut, yang sangat macam tidur tak lena, makan tak kenyang, sentiasa rasa terancam. So, jadi saya ingin tahu, pernahkah sebelum ini atau sedang berlaku satu penindasan bangsa oleh satu sama lain dalam negara ini berbanding dengan penindasan yang berlaku atas orang asli? So, itu saja yang saya ingin tanya. Terima kasih.
Okay, thank you, Tija. Unfortunately, maybe we will not respond to that, but thank you for that comment, and I think the speakers will maybe have a chance to respond to it after this, because we are really running short of time. Once again, but appreciate the comment, Tija, and yeah, noted. Yeah, it will be addressed later, no, by any one of you if you have an opportunity. Okay, with this, let's give a round of applause for both our speakers. We will end this session here and we will proceed to the next one, which I will pass the microphone to Ryan.